born and raised, I believe, in California, and attended UC Berkeley with a PhD from the University of California. Nafisha Haji has authored two books. Hopefully many of you are familiar with those books, The Writing on My Forehead and The Sweetness of Tears. And this particular workshop is on creative writing. So without further ado, I would just like to present Nafisha Haji, who will lead this session for this morning.
Thank you, Tony. If I stand here, can everyone see me rather than getting on the stage? And I don't want to be too loud. Because it's a workshop, I just thought I would work on my feet rather than sitting down. This was sort of added towards the last minute to my schedule. So I was kind of confused, as it normally a workshop would involve work from you. But 1 hour doesn't give us a lot of time, and it would be interactive. So I'm hoping at least to keep it interactive, even if I'm not going to ask you to get paper and pen out and start writing, at least to think about writing. So please talk and interrupt and shout at me if you don't like something I've said along the way. First of all, I wanted to just talk about what my qualifications are to talk about, that give me the right to talk about creative writing, and really, officially, I have none. I always wanted to be a writer, but I made a conscious decision not to study writing. I didn't study English in college and undergraduate. I studied history instead, because I figured I already knew how to write. And that's not necessarily true, but I figured that the more things I could learn about, the more informed my writing would be. And since those many, many years ago when I was an undergrad, the trend, we've heard about that in other sessions during this literature festival, has been to study writing in a more focused way. There's bachelors of fine arts in creative writing, and there are masters of fine arts, and those are the golden roads to success and publication, at least in the United States, and I think that sort of spills over all over the world. So I did not take the golden road, and that's why I'm saying I'm not qualified to talk about creative writing officially. When people ask me about what it takes to write, I go back to my roots as a classroom teacher. So what I did study was history, and then my graduate degree was in educational leadership, because I was a teacher. And I love that too. So it's not, I've left it behind temporarily, but I get to make up for it by doing things like this. So what I say, going back to being an elementary school teacher, how do children learn to speak? If a child is never spoken to, they will never learn to speak. And that's a fact. It's the way that our brains are built. And the same thing goes for writing. If you're here, you're interested in writing, or you're interested in writing because someone you know is interested in writing, and probably you are, even if you don't want to admit it, because it would be terribly boring to go and listen to somebody else talk about something that you're not interested in doing. So, number one thing, just like a baby needs to hear talking and be spoken to, you have to read, no matter what. That is how I learned, I figured, how to write. One of the things that you should also be doing is just reading things that you don't like and analyzing, I mean, that you don't normally pick up. And analyzing what you like in terms of what you like about things, what you don't like about things, because that will help clarify your own voice. And these are the basics. But for me, writing is storytelling. Storytelling predates the art of writing, before human beings had pen and paper. Papyrus, cuneiform. We were telling stories around fires. We were passing down our information. So it is storytelling, and storytelling has to begin, just like the reading, writing, the paradigm, with listening. And that the act of writing in order for someone else to hear the story that I'm, or to read the story that I'm desiring to tell, has to begin with me taking the same journey that I'm asking my readers to do. So if I'm asking them to metaphorically listen to a story that I'm telling, then I have to first engage in that act of listening. So listening is the basis of everything, because everything and everyone has a story, the way I see it, and not just one, but many. And that's why places like this, literature festivals, can be, believe it or not, places of anxiety for writers, because we get to meet each other, which is wonderful, but we get to meet each other, which is terrifying. All the insecurity of writing comes out as far as who's writing what, and what's this about, and what's that, and your competition, because most of us sit around and write in our pajamas at home, and we're pretty alone, and so being drawn out of having to get dressed up at all is terrifying, and then to talk to other people who are doing the same thing but doing everything so differently and brilliantly, and there's so much to admire, is always causes anxiety. The thing that helps me lessen my anxiety is knowing that there is no one story to any topic, that every writer in this room could be given the same object and would come up with a completely different story. And that's always important to remember. And we'll talk about that, because I'm going to introduce something to you all to think about in terms of stories. So the hardest thing about writing, especially I write novels, I've written short stories too, and the same thing applies. The hardest thing about writing is beginning and finishing and everything in between. But really it is, the beginning part for me involves always not thinking about the huge product ahead of you, not thinking about the big picture, but thinking in small terms, in bite-sized chunks of information. So whether it's a scene that's come to my mind, or a particular piece of dialogue, or one little thing that can be the seed for that big thing, and not concentrating on the big picture, because that's where the anxiety rises. So chunks of writing. In fact, I'm just starting to use it. You know, most writers use Microsoft Word or whatever word processors are out there, your basics, if you're writing on a computer. And there's a new, there's some software that writers have been raving about that is a word processor designed to write novels and screenplays, because that's the way it manages the information in little chunks, so you don't have that anxiety of a blank page that could go on forever and ever and ever, and that blank page is pretty terrifying. So always starting small, starting with the little seed, and not having the anxiety of the big picture overcome you is good. And I just want to talk about what happens to me when I have writer's block. And I think this ties into some of the other things. I touched base with some of the other writers who did some creative writing workshops, and it was uncanny how some of the same messages were going on and running through our conversations. The first book that I ever finished was The Writing on My Forehead. I had started many books before that, and always got stuck, and always left it behind, and then when it lays fallow and years later you come back to it, you've outgrown the work. Oftentimes it's very hard to pick up something that you wrote even a couple of years ago. You're older, you're wiser, you're more mature, and your writing looks less wise and less mature than you feel. Finishing the novel, the difference was this. Usually I'd get to a point where I was in conflict with the characters that had sort of taken life. I had an idea of what I wanted to write about, and suddenly the characters had taken on a life of their own and had an idea of where they wanted to go. And we would fight, and I would insist that I was right and the characters. If this sounds a little bit crazy, it's okay, because writing is a little bit crazy. I would insist on winning, and then the book would end there midway. What I've learned is that the characters ultimately do win that argument if the book is to be completed. So I've had villains turn into heroes because they decided they were going to be heroes. And I've had sympathetic characters turn into characters that I don't like at all because that's what they decided they were going to be. So that act of listening that I was talking about, it's not just listening to the world around you that you're going to be writing about, but also listening to the things you're creating as you're going through the writing process. So your characters will take on a life of their own, and you have to let them. And you have to let them live, and you have to let them tell you where to take you. And that's something that doesn't happen at the beginning. So that's why I was joking, but it's really true. The beginning is the hard part, and the ending is the hard part, and the middle is the hard. This is the middle hard part for me, where the writer's block happens. It's really once you've done the job of setting them up to have a life of their own, to let them live it. It's kind of like being a parent, I guess. My son is 12, so he's not a person yet, but he thinks he is, and I don't. So we're having writer's block, he and I. Just to give an example of what I was saying about every person and everything having stories and having a multiplicity of stories to tell. I just wanted to take out an object and share it and ask you to think about it, what its story might be. It's, as you can see, it's a handkerchief. And just look at it and think about think about listening to it. And what, I'm going to ask anybody who wants to volunteer what kind of story it might be telling them. So, a couple seconds of silence, thinking about a handkerchief. And the silence can be broken with anybody who wants to tell me anything about what they may have thought of, that opening scene, that idea. Yes, please.
I see. By seeing a handkerchief, I remember the olden days when my mother used to get the gifts of a handkerchief. When she used to open the box, and there used to be handkerchief, but no more handkerchiefs around.
Can you see the seed for a beautiful story? There's a relationship, a mother and a daughter. We have characters already. We have a sociological comment you just made about something that used to exist that doesn't. History. More hands. That was beautiful. Thank you. And it wasn't that scary, right? It wasn't that scary to raise your hand and say anything. Yeah, so you're there. Although sometimes writers are the most scared to talk, yes. I don't have that problem. Yes. I feel like Oprah.
Thank you. It was a beautiful handkerchief, having colors of red, green, bright colors, of course indicating some kind of romanticism. Maybe somebody has given a gift to the other one, and their feelings, emotions, everything is there in this handkerchief.
I love that. That was the relationship was only hinted at, but your story. Your story was visual and descriptive. And really, the object itself was your story. And so you're starting to ask and listen to the story of the handkerchief itself and where it came about.
Handkerchief perhaps belongs to a mother who's wiping her son's tears because he hasn't been admitted into a university. He's been rejected from, say, LSC.
Lovely. Another relationship. And the purpose of the handkerchief came out in your story. Beautiful. Anyone else? Okay, I'll go here and then I'll come there.
Well, I can relate this handkerchief to some sort of heritage thing, which is, now we can find only in the functions or ceremonies. Otherwise, I remember many years back, these were very common in our daily life. So this relates to our heritage as well, to me, actually.
That's right. It kind of ties back to your first one, too, as far as the sociological development of the fact that everybody carried handkerchiefs. And I'm going to go this way.
Actually, handkerchiefs has got some historical value as well, because during the freedom movement days, there was a movement called Reshmi Rumal Tehreek. It was a silken handkerchief. It was passed from one person to another, and whoever was ready to touch it, it means the person is showing commitment to the movement. The message was going on silently through that handkerchief. It is a fact recorded in the history, in our freedom movement history.
Okay. Have you written about that? Would you please? Because I did anybody else know about that? That historical, you did. Okay, so you'd heard, I'm assuming because there's a connection between you. That's wonderful. That's one of those golden nuggets. If you can stumble upon something that has that kind of significance, that's true. A whole, imagine all the stories that could be woven from that nugget. Amazing, I didn't know that. So now I'm gonna have to look it up. is there anyone else who wanted to share anything? This is what I mean. It's the combination and of the object itself and you as the lens, because you are part of the story, whether you like it or not, especially when you're writing fiction, even if you're writing nonfiction, because that's being done creatively as well now. You're part of the story because you bring all that you have experienced, all your knowledge, your family history to whatever it is that you happen to be looking at. We could see that in the different stories we heard about the handkerchief. I wanted to actually share the story of the handkerchief and why I happened to bring this artifact to talk about in a writer's workshop, because even though this one was a last minute, I will be holding another writer's workshop elsewhere. So I was thinking about middle school aged kids initially when I brought this. And this had been on my mind ever since I knew I was coming to the Karachi Literature Festival. Was it about a month and a month, or a month and a half, or a couple of months ago, where there was a big march, right, Imran Khan, and there was tens of thousands. So suddenly on my mind was this handkerchief, because it has many stories for me. Some of them relate to some of the stories that you shared. This handkerchief belonged to my grandmother. It came into my possession a few months after she passed away. We were at a birthday party in England. I was visiting England, and the birthday party was the first birthday birthday of a child whose grandfather was friends with my grandfather, and that's why I happened to be there. The family was conservative. It was a segregated party. Men were on one side and women were on the other. And all of a sudden there was a big buzz. This was back in the 80s, just to date myself. And lo and behold, in the corner, Imran Khan walked in. He was a guest at the party. And I was, as Tony mentioned, born and raised in the United States. The Pakistan cricket team is the one way that I felt Pakistani. probably a lot to do with Imran Khan. Those of you of my generation will know that everybody had a crush on Imran Khan at that time. And he was in a different incarnation. He was Mr. Westernized, but good representative of Pakistan. He was cultured and handsome and, you know, of course, the consummate athlete. And there he was in the segregated party, and all the girls on this side were drooling, and my aunt happened to be carrying a purse that belonged to my grandmother, pulled out the handkerchief, and told my cousin, whose name was also Imran, because I couldn't get up and cross that gender line, to get the handkerchief autographed for me. So it says, to Nafisa, best wishes, Imran Khan. So there's politics, there's history, there's family, my grandmother's handkerchief. My grandmother never left the house without a matching purse that had a handkerchief in it and a comb, which is ironic because I don't comb my hair at all. She wouldn't approve of me. And handkerchiefs, we touched on some of the sociological facts, but everybody used to carry handkerchiefs, men and women. Women used them as means of inviting courtship. men used them as a means of delivering courtship, a woman in tears and distress. Mothers and their children. I think Pakistani women still have a sort of nice, convenient substitute in our dupattas. So we use those freely to wipe our children's faces and tears, and they're not necessarily always hygienic. By the end of the day, those dupattas need to be washed oftentimes. So we have a substitute. But lots of different stories can be told, and I'm fascinated by the ones you came up with.
There's a question. Yes. I was just asking that, you know, all these ideas can come to you, but how do you knit it together?
Yeah, how do you knit it together? The scenes that mean the most to you are the ones that will stick. And for me, a lot of times I'll get an idea, I don't write them down right away. Some people, you know, I do sometimes if it's something that I'm worried that I'm going to, if it's the beginning of something that might not be complete. But if it's a complete thought, I don't write it down right away. For me, I wait. Because if it's good, it won't go away. It'll nag at me. It'll stay with me. I'll wake up with it. It will come back maybe even a month later in a more refined form. So that's the way I am. Now, some people, and by the way, I should have started with that caveat. There's no one way to write. There are as many people as there are writers. These are just ways to inform your own experiences, because you have to develop that yourself, how it works. So, you know, there are people who outline, there are people who don't outline, who map, who don't map.
Yeah. A story web, and all that. Yes. So.
And I do that too. I do it when I know I've got the writer's block and I'm fighting with my character. Usually when I'm doing things like that, I'm procrastinating. But they do help then when I'm done with the procrastination. They're there to look at. Yes, just rethink. And for some people, every chapter is blocked out. Every step of the short story is blocked out. And for some people, that would be terribly restrictive. And for me, it's a little bit of both. I usually have a general idea of the end of a story, but how I'm going to get there is the mystery. So it's like a journey that I have to get lost along the way to find the destination. For me, that's the way it works. I wanted to, what time is it? Oh, good, we have time. I wanted to share a little bit from my book that is not about writing. It's about faith, as in iman, faith. But to me, it's the way I think about writing as well and how we approach things. One of the things that I caution, because of the same things that I was saying about your characters winning, when you approach your writing from with the conclusion in your mind already, you've limited yourself. When you approach it from the point of view of these characters are going to teach me something, you get to be open. And there's a difference in the way it comes out. I mean, I can see it in myself. It's in one, I'm preaching and I've made the conclusion and I'm trying to teach. And teaching and writing don't go together. Learning and writing does. So if I can invite readers to learn along with me, that's a different experience than me telling them what they should be learning from the book. So that's what I want to read this portion about. And this is a character from my second novel. She's talking about faith. This book was a book about a very conservative, right-wing, religious Christian family, evangelical Christians, and a Muslim family of mixed sectarian heritage from Pakistan, and they're linked in ways they don't realize. And the reason I wanted to write about a Christian family was because living in the West, of course, like it or not, one of the things I'm doing all the time is trying to tell stories, to tell stories about a community, a faith, a culture that has been turned into a one-dimensional caricature of life. And just like anything else, what I love about visiting Pakistan is just walking around malls, streets, looking at families, and seeing in one family the diversity that's represented in terms of dress, level of practice of religion, how it's interpreted, the diversity that you see in ideas, in everything. One family is all it takes to break all the stereotypes that I'm constantly wrestling with over there. But like I said, I like to take the reader on a journey that I'm also taking. So I wanted to write about a community that I'm probably a little suspicious of, being the evangelical family. So if I was inviting my readers to break down stereotypes about Muslims, I also wanted to be able to do the same for myself and take that learning journey. So I spent a lot of time reading about Christianity and from all kinds of perspectives. And so this And the same thing I wanted to do, I wanted to humanize. So this is a particular community that is associated with a certain kind of political ideology that's sometimes not thought of as very tolerant. And I'm being hesitant about blanketing because my family is more complicated than that. So this particular character is Grandma Faith. And she's a bit of a rebel, very devout, very religious. She's a missionary. She goes all over the world, a medical missionary, so she gives children shots. But she gets very mad at some of her family and fellow religious missionaries. And so this scene, she's getting mad about how certain they are about their faith and that their religion is the right religion. Feel free to think any of this is familiar because we all know Muslims that are just like that. Certainty is always a dangerous thing, and it's definitely dangerous as a writer because you want to be uncertain. And this is what Faith has to say. And by the way, she travels around the world, so she makes her grandchildren call her different things every year. She's Grandma Faith. She went to Africa and learned that in Swahili, grandma is Bibi, so that year she was Bibi Faith. She's Abuela Faith. She keeps teaching them different languages. So this year she was Bibi because they were in Africa and her grandkids went with her. Grandma Bibi Faith stomped off in a tizzy. I found her muttering to herself again way up one of the dearth paths in the village. Nothing worse than the smug smell of certainty. They're all reeking with it. She waved her hands wildly in a way that indicated not just the reporter but her own son as well. I was quiet for a moment. But isn't certainty a good thing? It's the opposite of doubt, I said, thinking of the wall at camp that had been so hard to climb. It's what faith is all about. Not when it makes you willfully blind to the truth. That's not faith. That's belief. a decision, a line in the sand. It's telling yourself, this is what I believe in, and anything or anybody that doesn't fit is the enemy. If faith isn't belief, then what is it? To me, faith is revelation. And in order to receive revelation, you have to be open. Belief is about closing yourself off, a lie you tell yourself to make the world fit in with how you've decided it should be. Real faith is an action, a verb. It's truth unfolding. You have to let yourself be vulnerable to let that happen. You can't hide from it. You can't run away from it. You can't drown it out, covering your ears while you shout out declarations of belief. That's not faith, that's cowardice, a fear of truth, which is only scary when you're fighting to keep yourself from knowing it. Do you know what the first phrase I learn is when I go to a new place where they speak a language I don't understand? I shook my head, still digesting what she'd already said. I don't understand. I don't know, BB Faith said. It's the most liberating bunch of words you can learn in any language. When you admit your own ignorance to yourself and to others, you open the door to the kind of revelation, real faith, that I was talking about. The strangers I meet in foreign places slow down when I say those words. They start paying attention to my face to see if I get what they're saying. It brings out the kindness in folks. I've had people, all kinds, men, women, children, literally take my hand and guide me to the place I'm asking directions for, miles out of their way. Waiters in restaurants have chosen my meal for me, and it's always the best stuff on the menu. People will help you shop. They'll take care of you if you let them know the truth, that you don't understand, that you're ignorant, that you're lost. It's the best part of going to a new place, because you've admitted something that's true for all of us, whether we admit it to ourselves and to each other or not, that we're all vulnerable. It's like going back and getting to be a kid. You're not afraid of breathing through your mouth, of letting your eyes drink everything in wide open, that cynical slit of the eyelids that we all have to practice and perfect in front of the bathroom mirror disappears, and all those muscles in your face that you have to flex to look smart, get to relax. And it's wonderful. All the pretense of adulthood melts away. It's all crystal clear. That I don't know a damn thing about anything, and that's okay. Good, in fact. Kind of like what Jesus said in Matthew, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Diving into a new place, a new language, that's the closest I've ever come to understanding what that verse means, BB Faith said. So she's talking about faith, but that's kind of thank you. That's kind of my feeling about writing, to approach it from a point of view of ignorance. I don't know. And that takes some doing, because I was a pretty self-righteous young person, as most of us are. We think we know everything by, what is it, 16? You've decided, you've figured everything out, and then you have to realize, the rest of your life you spend unlearning and really realizing how dumb you are, which is good. It's good. So any more questions and answers? We're done, and I'm done with my portion of the presentation, so I would love to hear. Yes?
How do you write? Do you write by hand? Do you write by computer? Does your mind run faster than the
book? Yeah, I think I do occasionally. My first novel, I still have the habit of, I had to start by hand. I don't know, it was the process of the slowness, it's my generational thing. The first paragraph, always, by hand. And then once I had that first paragraph, I could go straight up on the computer, and that was like, it was like the charge, I could go. But now I'm most of the time I do start on the computer. I'll still go back to a notebook when I'm stuck, and just sort of work it out and rewrite the same thing over and over again. Just the act of rewriting, hopefully getting that jump start. It's kind of like turning the crank of the car when the battery is dead. It'll catch this time. This time it'll catch. And it does. I think it works better. Yes?
I have a question. I find that, I'll start something, and then what happens is I won't even be like a couple of, 20 or 30 pages in, and another idea will come, and then I'll start going with that. So, what I think is, how do you, apart from discipline, the stamina to sit down and go through the whole story, Is there anything you can suggest for that?
No, because I'm learning my way through that too. I until now, for the first two novels, I did them exclusively. When I was writing book one, it was all I did. I did start book two while I was still revising book one. But this time around, I can relate to what you're doing, because I'm writing two books simultaneously. So it's kind of a fun process. They're kind of racing in my head, so I don't know which one I'll finish first, and they're very different books. So, I mean, if that's a dilemma, I mean, be grateful, because there'll be times when you have no ideas in your head. So, and that's definitely more of a desperate time than when you have too many. So always start with that gratitude. If you've got stuff going on in your head, that's good. Yeah, that's good. And yeah, just keep the simultaneous notes going so you can keep in touch with both. And what I'm hoping will happen for me, and hopefully it'll happen for you too, both will catch on and stay alive, but one will catch on enough that you'll actually have the stamina to finish. So, and it's about form. It's once there's a point where they've gotten to so much form. When I was talking about the characters writing, telling me and winning, there comes a point where I'm waking up in the morning going, I wonder what's going to happen next. It's almost like I get to be the reader. Once I have surrendered to the characters and I'm not trying to make them do what I want them to do anymore, when I let them take on that life that I was talking about, that I resent them for in the beginning, then I get to go along for the ride. And it's when you hit that sweet spot, it's really fun. But it takes a while to get there. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. Your conversations are very engaging. I was wondering, as a writer, one is going through a self-reflective process, and at times, does it moreover limit ourselves when we are trying to explore the characters that we want to, or when we are trying to maybe develop a plot, or when we are trying to, is it moreover a limitation, this self-reflective process, and how can we overcome that barrier as a writer? Because sooner or later, I mean, our writing comes through our observations, our experiences. How could we maybe stop or inhibit ourselves from limiting our own exploration process?
Okay, I want to make sure I understand what you're saying. So, right, being writers, we're self-reflective, and you don't want the self-reflection to get in the way of the development of your characters. Is that what you meant?
Not to hamper that exploration process, and maybe we could go beyond ourselves.
Are you talking about like self-consciousness?
Yes, no, everything.
Yeah.
Self-consciousness, our values, our beliefs,
yeah.
Our faith.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very subjective.
I agree.
There are some universal factors, yes, but then again,
absolutely. And I think you shouldn't fight that. That's just a given. You are the product of everything that the universe has put into making you, including generations of ancestors and the place you were born and the culture you were born into and the faith you were born into, whether you kept it or not or refined it or changed it, edited it, whatever that is. So there's no reason to hide from that. I think that is, when we were talking about the handkerchief, that is what gives you the ability to flavor the way you look at things. So if you're trying to escape, it's almost like the journalist's dilemma of objectivity. I don't buy that. There's no such thing. And we live in a world where we darn well know that. We know that what channel, I'm not as familiar with Pakistani media other than, you know, the traditional Dawn and things like that. And I follow that on Twitter, so just to keep abreast. But we know that the channel you watch, the newspaper you read, it's all filtered through a particular worldview and class, and you can't hide from it. I think you have to acknowledge it, park it somewhere, and then there is, I think, a responsibility. I'm not knocking the idea of objectivity, but objectivity has to be understood within the context of the fact that there are some things you're just not even going to be aware of that you're bringing to your writing. And so, and as far as the self-consciousness, the other thing I really try and do is inhabit the characters. And so that was what was fun about writing that second book, was there were characters that were completely alien to my experience in terms of myself. I mean, I've encountered evangelical Christians in the world, but I really wanted to inhabit that world in my head. And I think in a way, especially writers who are into dialogue and character development, I think that they're frustrated actors in some way. Because what you're doing is you're acting, but you're just doing it in the privacy of your own home without an audience. Your audience comes later. So there are times when I read aloud every single thing I write to at least two people, intimately acquainted, my spouse and my mother, who will never say anything mean. Well, sometimes they will, but it's not mean, it's well meant. And I'll fight with them, and then I'll do exactly, especially my husband. I, you know, disagree with everything he says critically, and then do exactly what he says, because he's always right. Darn it. But I think it's good to go with it, and I think that that living, that inhabiting the skin, and ultimately, isn't that why we all love to read? I mean, you're here at the Literature Festival, you're here in this session, so I know you have an interest in writing. But the reason you're here is because you love to read, and what reading has done for all of us is given us the opportunity, as much as it is possible, to live somebody else's truth. When we read something completely alien, we do that. And so that's what you want to give to your reader, here and there then, is the ability to live to their truth. To live in another truth. So you don't want to hide from that too. So thank you. Good question. Complicated one.
I read a lot of books, and I want to write books for young children. So can you please guide like, how to start writing for young children?
Okay. So what grade are you in? Eighth grade. So you're done with, are you still learning grammar and punctuation? Are you still doing that with in school? Are you like into, yeah, I mean, you spend years doing that, right? Doesn't it feel repetitive sometimes? I think that's across educational systems. Even as a teacher, I felt sorry for the kids. How many times they had to learn about nouns and verbs and agreement and subject. But it is really important to know the basics, to know the rules. There are rules for a reason. Ultimately, because once you've mastered the rules, you get to break them. And that's when you really take the next step. If you break them without knowing them, readers can tell. They can tell that you don't know what you're doing. If you break them when you know the rules, then you're a master, and readers can tell that too. They can tell you're actually in the act of creation. So for the young, you know, all the basics and the boring and all of that. And the other thing is that listening. Just work on that listening and the reading, because the listening is what is going to filter into listening to the object, listening to the story, listening to the voices around you, and practicing that acting in your head. Can you imitate dialogue? Maybe you're not an actor, really, and you can't do it out loud, but in your head, can you get the nuance of the sounds of the way people speak? And things like that. And that's me, that's my lens. I remember the gentleman who talked about the handkerchief in visual terms, so there's that too, the descriptions and all of that. Does that help? Yeah? So, rules. I said to this lady, and then, yes.
I have a daughter who's 12 years old, and she's an avid reader. She reads voraciously everything. I think she's read more than I have. I want her to become a writer. There's always this block, and she's reluctant. She doesn't want to write. She loves to read. But when she writes, she writes well. You know, how do I encourage her?
That's a good one. I think... You can't make anybody want to write, and I did not write. There are some people who wrote from the age of whatever, and they never stopped writing, they're still writing, they write all the time, they write every day. That's not the kind of writer I was. I always knew I wanted to be a writer, but I'm essentially a very lazy person. So, you know, I would let her go with the reading and not, definitely, it's a chore anyway. It is. It's, you know, Doris Lessing, or who said, or I love writing, but I hate writing, but I love having written. Toni Morrison quoted her, I think it was. So, and that's true. So if she's reading and she's good at it, it'll come. I think that the reading is what should be encouraged. That's the most important thing. Well, yeah. Yeah, she will. She will, maybe when she feels like she has something to say. And I wasn't one of those who was writing and submitting for contests and doing, you know, there's a lot of pressure to be at a very young age. And I believe in the caterpillar and the butterfly. So we have to let the caterpillars in the cocoon have their privacy. And then when they burst forth, and there's no poking or prodding you can do to that cocoon that's going to speed anything up. when it's ready, it's going to open and it will be beautiful. So, does that help? That's just a modern dilemma of motherhood. I think we all have that balance of wanting to make sure they're doing really well. And I'm a little bit of a different. I mean, I believe that pushing some children can help, but if she's already a great writer and she's reading, then just let her keep going on that route.
Nothing about discipline,
no. No, definitely not. She has to develop that on her own as a writer. I mean, if she's going to be a writer, yeah. And you can't make a writer. She'll either be one or she won't. Sorry, I was on her side, not on yours.
Ashley, just keeping on the subject of children, I'd just like to understand, how would you encourage children without being disciplinary, like in a young children to express their expressions and things like that? How would you go about it? What advice would you give to parents to do that?
This isn't just me. This is the educator in me talking. It's the research. It's reading, 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 reading. Just loving reading. And so, you know, in utero, you want to be reading to them before they're born. That's also proven to, they hear your voice and they get it. And that's, you know, I bet you read a lot to your daughter. That's why she loves reading. And that's the same thing. I mean, my son too. It's pretty miraculous. And the other thing is, reading with them when they're young, and then continuing to read in front of them. Now, my son is 12. We still do read-alouds together. We still curl up in bed at bedtime, and I read to him. He still likes to hear me read to him. And I think that as long as your child, I mean, if there's anything pushy that I would probably have a hard time giving up, it would be that. Luckily, he likes it still. But I like shared reading, too, and I think that's something that you can continue. We give that up too soon. We think, okay, now they know how to read, let them read on their own. But shared communal reading is a really good thing. And other than that, really, I think the love of reading itself is enough. Yeah, here and then there.
I want you to think back to your school days. Is there anything that helped you start off as a writer in your middle school level that you were taught? Or?
My school days. I would start a lot of things, never finish anything. So the discipline thing, I didn't have it. And that's why I get, and some probably do, I just don't see that would have helped me. So I wasn't very disciplined, I didn't finish. Essays here and there, I did win a contest once. And but it's, yeah, I think that when I was ready to write, I wrote. No, I mean, other than the encouragement, being told, you're good at this, that's good. That makes it, that's money in the bank. I may not spend it right away, but being told you're good at this is good. If you're good at it. Otherwise, it can be bad. So.
Just to say something to the parents here, you know, just the idea of just doing free writing, just having like a diary and just let them write whatever they want. So that's like encouraging them, but not being too much of a disciplinarian.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing that up. As a teacher, that's what I would do. Just a journal. Journal writing is good. And not that they ever have to share or that you're ever going to look at it unless they want to read something aloud. Encouraging them to read out loud to you rather than, what did you write today? You know? Yeah. Yeah, and that's great. Then she's already there, so don't worry.
Can you kindly describe the thought process that goes on regarding the observation, the art of observation that you have based on seeing like people you describe, families, or what you have read, or what is that basic thought process behind that goes?
That's a good one, and I don't know if it can be answered consciously. I think it's one of those long-term cooking projects. It's just like nihari, paktai, 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 and then, you know, one day it's cooked. I mean, one moment it's... I don't know if it's a conscious, because sometimes it surprises me. It's not a timeline. The things that suddenly surface, the experiences that I've had that have been there for years, and then suddenly I know I want to write about them. So I don't think it's something that you can be... Well, for me, my experience is not something you can be aware of. Or something that you know is interesting and you go, I'm going to think about that, but I can't think about it now, or it's too fresh and you just sort of park it away. I take notes, I write things down, but I never refer to them again. So that's when that one of those initial questions of I know it's going to come back because it stays with me and it keeps coming back, then I know I have to write about it. But the thought process is just too intuitive for me to consciously talk about, I think. Sorry.
A a lot of people asking questions about how to encourage children, and you're right, you can't really push that process. But one of the things we found that's very useful is free writing. So what we do with, you know, a 10-year-old is we both sit down and write for about 90 seconds whatever comes into our minds. And that gets them over that first paragraph, fear. And so that's very constructive, and then they're on their own. After that, they enjoy doing that on their own. But my question to you is, this new breed of books like, you know, Diary of a Wimpy Kid, and, you know, Photograph, Short Sentences, Bad Grammar, do you believe that let them read whatever they enjoy, or do you think this kind of destroys their writing skills?
Good question, and thanks for the further advice. So one more recommendation on the free writing, and that is true. The Diary of a Wimpy Kid and the new stuff, I mean, think of the world we're living in, of Twitter and Facebook and grammar and punctuation. This bothers me, and this is the teacher side of me, the lack of punctuation and grammar, and I just can't help it, and I know I'm old and fuddy-duddy and all that. But partially, yes, I believe they should be allowed to read what they like. But I guess one of the ways I mitigate that as a mother is that read aloud that we still do. So I get to, you know, I'll read aloud things that he wants me to, but then I get to choose to. So I insert myself in whenever possible. And it's always led to good things. We had a whole Southern run where we did Mark Twain, and I got to do my Southern accent in the privacy of my son's bedroom, so nobody had to critique me. And then we did To Kill a Mockingbird, and we did so classics and things like that that he may not pick up, I will put in our hands together, and then they lead, one thing leads to another. So that's how I would do it, to be sneaky. So, is that lights off for time? Yes.
I have a couple of questions. The first question is, when you're writing a longer narrative, how do you pace the narrative? And secondly, when you're starting something, then, like you said, it's an evolutionary process in terms of the characters and the story. So at the start, the characters aren't fully developed. So how do you get the voice of the character right at the start?
Great questions. I know I have that opening scene down, and then I have, before I've even written it, because it's been there for a while, like I said, I let it stew, and I know it's gonna stay and be powerful enough because it's been in my head for a long time before I even typed it in. Last question, okay, this one that I'm answering. And I know that, then I have spent a lot of time stewing, and that voice has been developing in my head. So, and that voice will change. The plot and the characters' actions will change. That's when I'm wrestling with the characters. But the voice, by the time I'm actually starting the novel, I feel like I know who that person is, and that comes with just the stewing and the sitting and the thinking. And there's that phase where my husband says I have a glazed over look on my face, and I turn, you know how we women complain, and this is generalizing and stereotyping, but we'll complain about men who don't listen, and we're talking and they tune out and they're pretending they're listening. I become that in the house, so because I'm listening to the voices in the head. So I think that for me, that happens before I'm actually there. And then it has to readjust along the way. That's when I have stoppages and blockages. So. Thank you. Thank you so much. This was wonderful. Thank you for coming.